We've heard a lot about the change that's taking place in modern and traditional retail. And one of the things that's kept cropping up through the morning is how we're going to deal with the phygital area. Back in the old days, it used to be brick and mortar versus online, but we keep creating new words as we go along. Well, what are the implications for policy making? What's going to be happening in this phygital space as we go forward, not just through 2019 and 2020, but for the 5 years beyond that? I'd like to call on stage our panel, Saurabh Kumar, founder of Grofers, Arvind Varchaswi, Managing Director, Sri Sri Tattva, Sudhir Sitapati, Executive Director, Food and Refreshment at Hindustan Lever, Ian Wright, Chairperson, Food and Drink Federation, United Kingdom, and to moderate the discussion, Sadashiv Nayak, CEO of the food business at Future Group.
Good afternoon and namaste. I think some bit of hustle there. We'll try and keep the discussion as interactive as possible. I'm reminded of, you promised to tell us what phygital is all about. Saurabh has promised to tell us what phygital is all about. But I thought we'll kind of keep the discussion in the space of what's likely to happen in the future. So feel free to kind of raise your hand and ask anyone any question as we go along. I think I'm reminded of a book by Disney. I don't know how many of you read it. It's called The Magic Kingdom. Has anyone read the book The Magic Kingdom by Disney? No one? Okay, there you go. The proud single person who's read in the gang. Yeah. So I think the book has an interesting anecdote, and I wanted to bring it up as a context. When the people were asked saying, whom do you fear as competition? This is Disney, the amusement park. I think they referred to their competition as Federal Express or DHL. I don't know which one was the company, but they referred to as a courier company being a competitor to Disney. And I think that kind of sets the tone because this was an era in 70s when there was possibly only Disney and no other amusement park. And their point of view was that as an entertainment company, as a consumer company, people are also calling up courier companies and tracking their orders. If they get used to a certain amount of service, I think they're going to expect the same service from Disney and maybe we'll let them down. So that's how they define competition. And when you look at all that's happening around us, be it in terms of Instagram, be it in terms of the social networks, be it in terms of Netflix, I believe in some way the food and grocery trade and retail and brands are competing with them. And hopefully we'll try and build that as a thread. So today, jokingly, when I talk about early days, and I represent Big Bazaar, a retailer in food, I think when you earlier on, when there was a complaint, it would be addressed locally. The customer would come, blast us out, and we would address it. Now, the moment something happens, I think it's all over 50,000 people on WhatsApp suddenly accessing, saying, oh, these guys did not have their scales calibrated. Whether it's right or wrong, I think people finally make their own judgments. But it's a place when things can just move at the speed of lightning. If you think about Netflix, and that's a challenge which I keep asking my team. I don't know how many are from retail here. I think we've started with the concept of planogramming and merchandising. But Netflix today is redefining the concept of planogramming. I mean, your screen of Netflix is your screen, which is different from his screen, which is different from his screen. So how are our static planograms either on the web or on the physical stores, how are we going to compete with a customer getting used to my personal screen of Netflix? I think those are some of the questions which are lying. Fortunately or unfortunately, we have a very diverse group of people on the panel. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to really start off with some questions. And then maybe we can open up midway for some questions and come back to any other discussion which you need to have. Let me start with you, Arvind. I think I had a wonderful chat with him in the speaker's lounge. Whoever gets a chance, please grab some time with him. I think you opened up stores now. In a recent tweet, I heard you talk about sports and the impact of sports, and you represent, among many other things, the consumer goods business. What is your outlook in the scenario which is ahead, which is what we're really discussing here today? How do you see impacting the ecosystem, impacting consumption? I mean, can you share your thoughts on that?
Sadashiv, thank you so much for your fantastic opening remarks. You know, a lot of it lies in something that what you mentioned, that the advent of social media and information and education that's come across to people right now is at the straight at the palm of your hand. So as what you mentioned, that a decade back, perhaps if there was something wrong in the store, then you come and address it. But now, the moment it's wrong, it's out there on social media, you need to attend to it immediately. So similarly like that, this same education has also happened in the space of health and also fitness. A decade back, a sports person would be looked at as a person for fitness. All right, you see a person who's fit. But now you also see that these people are able to educate people that what is their methodology of fitness and why do you need to be fit? And also what India has shown across to the world, that being fit is just not enough physically, but also mentally. That you could have a great physically fit athlete, but if he's depressed, or he or she is depressed, then what's the use? So that's where I feel that A, there's education, B, there is accessibility through technology, and that's where we also as a brand have seen that we push a lot more content when it comes to educating the customer about what's good for them. So we are there in a lot of spaces, right, from healthcare to FMCG, and I would say healthy FMCG, and also Ayush products. So here we are educating people through social media, through technology, and also seeing that the other system that what you mentioned, to also deliver this more efficiently to them, right from traditional trade and also modern trade and also e-commerce through our own apps and also strategic tabs with other people. So I really feel that technology does play a great role in this entire function of educating the customer today. Customer has always been king, but today you also have an educated customer that what you have to deal with. And that's where all the products that what, as a brand, that what you bring across need to be more responsible. And that's where I think that what our brand stands for is quality, authenticity. And also we take pride in giving the best to the consumer and what is it that what they want. So as a brand, even the arsenal of products that what we have been built up over the years from customer feedback. What exactly does the customer want? And then later we launch the product. So definitely it goes through that entire back end of research and everything that what we need to do. But definitely we take it from the customer, seeing that what is it that what we want. And as an organization, we also educate people as to what's good for them. So all the more responsibility. So when it comes to the sportsmen, as what you mentioned, we do have Pulela Gopichand and PV Sindhu as our brand ambassadors. They epitomize fitness and also health for a person who's young and also old. So then later, so both of them also meditate. Both of them also do practices. Both of them also ensure that their health is taken care of. So this actually percolates down to the customer to say that I want to be healthy. That's where we've started off our space.
So hand on heart, just to kind of rebound the question back to you, isn't it a very slow process? I hear you saying that, you know, we want to educate, we want to do it, but finally it's fast moving consumer goods. I mean, is it really fast enough for you to kind of keep up pace?
See, as an organization, especially on the FMCG space, however fast you run is not fast enough. But I think social media is definitely doing the trick to at least amplify your speed to at least you keep up to the customer. And I think we're definitely harnessing that. And it's also more viable, right? That especially when you have your own verified handles, your reach to people is instantaneous and it's also direct. It's direct communication. So what used to happen before is that I wouldn't be able to speak to you directly if I were to want to give you some feedback. But with the advent of social media, you're able to communicate with me and me to you. And that's really transformed how even customers and consumers behave. They're able to give the feedback to the person who matters. And sometimes if the person who matters does not know, now he does not have any other option but to know. That's what's changed.
Thank you. Sudhir, I'll move on to you. And I kind of bumped into this video of you in the month of December. I think it was a global investor meet. And I must tell you, for those, you can go and search for Sudhir HUL on the web. As an Indian, it feels quite proud because the stage was taken by two Indians, Nitin Paranjpe and Sudhir. So you did mention their gray spaces. And I think what I could understand with my limited knowledge is, you said there are spaces where the Unilever world is present in and they are not possibly represented well in India. Now, that sounds good, but I want to really ask you, is it really feasible if Unilever is big in sauces in India? Are you going to make sauces mainstream here? And I'm not referring to the tomato ketchup. I'm referring to many more products, which possibly Unilever has way ahead moved on in the food space. But you mentioned gray spaces, and within that, you did mention small towns. So I want to talk a little bit about it and try and take away some bit of skepticism, which I have, saying, is there really a gray space in the country?
Yeah, so thanks, Sadashiv. When I said gray spaces, you know, normally when we look at new brands or new geographies to enter, we think in terms of white spaces. You know, this is a white space. It's an easy place for me to win because it's white. There's nobody else there. But actually, white spaces are very difficult to win because, you know, the habit is not built, consumers are not ready, et cetera, et cetera. So gray spaces are what I call, you know, a category is present in the geography, but under-penetrated, you know, sub 5%, sub 6%. And once categories reach 5 or 6%, that's when you can really explode categories and sort of grow them fast. And that's what I call gray spaces. Zero is white, 50 is, you know, already occupied, 5 to 10 is a gray space. And I was talking about a lot of foods categories. Foods, you know, is still a tiny, tiny part of what it's going to be in the next 20, 30 years in India. And there are towns which are, forget about the villages, but even 1 lakh towns where there are plenty of categories in this gray space zone between 5 and 10% penetration. And I was referring to ice creams, which is one of the categories that we operate in, really being well penetrated in the big top 7-8 cities. But in, you know, as the moment you go to the next 100 cities, it's a gray space with 5 to 10% penetration. And we see that as the kind of big opportunity as HUL in India. And that's what I meant by a gray space.
Aren't you bogged down by the scale of setting up a cold chain? How do you reach Jhumri Talaya or how do you reach Tirupur and, yeah, and kind of
so
reach
Jhumri Talaya is not a gray space. It's a white space, which is why we don't go there. So a gray space is something like, let's take for ice creams, a Gwalior is a gray space or a Jabalpur is a gray space. It's not that hard to go to many of these gray spaces in food. So unlike in personal care where, you know, penetrations are very, very high in rural India, in packaged foods, one doesn't have to think of the whole of India or rural India or 50,000 population towns. I mean, the action is still in 1 to 10 lakh where there's plenty of infrastructure available and it's only category development that has to be done.
Anyone from Jharkhand can have his fight, her fight or his fight with him later on. He called it a white space.
I've been to Jhumri Talaya.
Yeah, even I've been there. So we had two choices today in the panel. One was to do a panel as we are trying to do now, trying to hold your attention before lunch. The other one we had was to call Ian, who's come in from UK and discuss Brexit. He said he can go on for 3 hours, and then Amitabh came in and said, you know, restrict it to 35 minutes. So we're not going to discuss Brexit, but kind of shoot your points later. Ian, I kind of read about you and did a little bit of research, and I did hear you also link Brexit to what you're doing. My question to you really is about, I think the space where you are, I think, which is really getting people to collaborate, being the industry voice, being a policy voice, and I'm now trying to look at what we've been asked to do in the area of phygital, in the area of tomorrow. Where do you see this leading to? I mean, will people collaborate? Where do you kind of balance out competition and collaboration? If you want to share your experiences.
First of all, thank you for inviting me, and apologies for being a kind of interloper at your panel. I'm far less erudite than any of the speakers you've got alongside me. I think there's a really interesting question for UK and indeed participants in the UK market, food and drink market, in terms of what you've asked, because we have a highly competitive retail food market. Probably the maddest and most competitive in the world. And if you think that is an exaggeration, You earlier had the very distinguished president and CEO of Walmart speaking to you, and I know how well regarded he and his business is in this country. Well, in effect, Walmart have given up in the UK, and they've decided to sell their business to Sainsbury. Now, that is an indication, if the world's greatest bricks and mortar retailer cannot make it in the UK, then you really are in an interesting place. So the competition is critical, and of course, the competition is also coming from digital. And the question is, can traditional manufacturers find a way through that and still make money? And with margins in the UK in low single digits, that's an absolutely critical question. And I guess the area is in expertise and in the way in which we approach the shopper. Now, you'll hear me in this panel talk almost exclusively about shoppers. Coming from my previous existence in Diageo, I know that shoppers are more important to, certainly to beverage alcohol players in retail than consumers. And I'll give you one anecdote on that, if I may. And I hope this is, although this is a gender-specific remark, it is, I hope, not offensive. The truth is that if you're trying to sell Guinness to consumers, do not do it through retail in the UK, because most UK shoppers in retail are women, and most women in the UK think Guinness tastes disgusting. And as a consequence, when their partner asks for Guinness, they buy something else. And we struggled with that for decades until we worked out that if we made Guinness associated with rugby, it would work. So, I mean, I think it is a really big challenge, and I do think that there is room for collaboration, but it will be about how you reach the shopper rather than the proposition you put to the shopper, because that's competitive.
So, Saurabh, I think we heard Sudhir talk about gray spaces and white spaces. Where are you from, Saurabh? Are you from Jharkhand by any chance?
Yes.
You are from Jharkhand? Okay, fine. The last round is between the two of you, Sudhir. Okay, they called it a white space. So my question to you is, I think when I went and checked what you had to say about the Grofers model, I think it was in contrast, at least that's my understanding, to what Unilever has been following, what Sudhir represents them here, which is to say, okay, there's enough and more in the towns, in the urbanized towns, and we should kind of chase that. So question really to you is that a conscious step? Because typically when anyone approaches the country, be it an Indian or someone from outside, I think you end up looking at that huge 130 crore population. Is it a conscious choice to say, no, let's stay focused on these urban cities? And within that, my question to you, because you keep talking about we are there for the middle class, both the upper and lower middle class. Is there a model which you see emerging for the urban poor? Because if it's Mumbai, there is 5 million of them whom we could classify as urban poor. So do you see models like yours, Grofers, who can actually cater to them? Yeah.
Thanks, Sadashiv. I think to take cue from Sudhir, that's our gray space. What we believe is that the next 100 million customers that are coming online in India, majority of them will belong to this category, what we call as motorcycle families. Motorcycle families in India, right? This is a segment that is now a lot more empowered. They have, grocery as a purchase and food as a purchase, right? This is more of a household purchase rather than an individual purchase. And a lot of these households now have an additional smartphone in their household, which has really given an access to these households to go out and start purchasing online as well. So this is one segment that we really believe that is going to come online in the next couple of years, and the first purchase that they will do online will probably be food and not electronics and fashion, which is the early adopters of e-commerce in India, right? Another reason why we want to go after this segment is this is also the most aspirational segment in India, while they struggle with the access problem. When you look at the areas where modern retail in India is populated, it's still mostly in the affluent areas in the cities, right? We believe that with e-commerce, we can really solve the access problem for a lot of these households, where we can reach out to a bigger audience, where the customers have the aspirations, but they do not have access to either value or assortment, which we can provide them and be able to cater to this segment.
Okay. Good to say that I'm catering to the motorcycle population or generation, that's what you called it. But when I'm going back and linking hard to the urban poor, is there really any consumption there at all? I mean, isn't it in pockets? Isn't it the ultimate Netflixization, as I call it? You know, watch it for 2 hours and then keep it aside, then watch it for 5 minutes and keep it aside.
See, food is not a discretionary purchase for any of the household,
right?
It is
not, but can the portions be discretionary?
Yeah, that's the whole point around this, right? With most of these families, if you look at their wallet size that they spend on food, it's not considerably smaller than more affluent families. And in fact, the behavior that we have seen, a lot of these families do a lot more stock up purchases than more affluent families. When they see value in something, they really want to spend their money there. And that is the behavior that we believe is going to multiply, where people see, okay, I want this product and I'm getting the right value around this, I will buy this product. So we believe that this segment, in terms of just the sheer amount of consumption that this 100 million customers are going to do, will be much bigger opportunity in India than the real affluent section in India, right?
Sure. So I want to just take a quick dipstick summary. I think there is a person here who's saying, be back value-based products, talk to people individually, and there's a opportunity there. Sudhir brought in saying the space of white space, gray space, saying there's enough and more to occupy in spaces which are far off from us. Ian brought in saying, and he had in his short call gave two anecdotes and said, competition is a necessary
evil
or fact, and so kind of face it. And you had Saurabh who came back and said that there is a market out there. You know, we can pick a choice, we can keep away the white space of urban of towns and just focus on the opportunity. How many of you kind of so far kind of agree with the points being made by the panel? I just want to see whether you're listening or not. A show of hands. Okay, right. So I think let's move to the next one. Amitabh, you have to raise your hand. we'll move to the next section, which is saying, I don't know, right? And I'm going to ask, open it up and we can have the microphones going. If these are the points which the panel is raising for consumption in the future phygital generation, we take a pause and say, do you want to ask any question which says, guys, I don't know what you're saying about this particular point. Sudhir, I don't know how you're going to reach ice cream in a very hot place far off from Calcutta. If there's any question which begins with, I don't know, I would really request you to raise your hand and ask the panel here, because the next section I will be asking them certain questions which I don't know.
My question is about the urban poor we are talking about here. Don't we think that they, even though they will be entering into the digital population force of India, but they get intimidated with the idea of ordering on a Grofers or a Big Basket or going to a brick and mortar store, rather an organized retail store, say a food hall, and shop from there. So even though we are looking at that population, but don't we think that that will be getting limited to a more traditional store or they'll be picking up stuff from there and not translating to your business?
So if I can take the liberty of recrafting, I don't know whether your model will ever appeal to the urban poor because they're not digitally connected. I think that...
Yes, that was the case. In fact, 5 years back when we started the business, that was not the customers that we were primarily focusing on. But what is happening now is that... See, fundamentally what is happening is the information asymmetry is disappearing from the market. The advantage that a lot of sellers had over buyers was that, okay, I have a lot more information that the buyers have. Now that itself is disappearing. A lot, the customers that we are talking about, right, the motorcycle families that we are talking about, most of these people are consuming data now. They have a lot more access to information. What these customers are saying that, okay, I want certain things. I want these kind of food products, I want these products at these quality of products, I want these prices to pay for it. Wherever they see that is available, they will gravitate towards that. So we are seeing that a lot more customers that are coming online and buying are from the economically weaker section rather than the more affluent one. The affluent people are already online. They already have access to these information. They already know where they can buy products from. A lot of these segments which are coming online now, they are realizing that the products that they had access to was either of inferior quality or they weren't getting their value for money with those products. So they are in the lookout for where can they get that value, and that with the access of data, they are able to now choose where they want to buy their products from.
He seems to know.
And will language be a barrier for them?
We haven't seen language to be that big a barrier. We also have now vernacular apps in most of the regions in India. But I think pictures does wonder. Most people are able to just see what the products are and buy.
Which is the second I don't know question. Yes.
Hi. This quite intrigued me, the concept of white space and the gray space. So there are a lot of markets where we are opening stores of 1,000 square feet in and around Rajasthan, Ahmedabad, Gujarat and all these places. So there are categories, there are consumers which I feel, you know, can fit in both these spaces. So I just would like to know your opinion on that front.
White spaces have to be penetrated at some point of time for them to become gray and then, you know, dark or black spaces. But the point I'm making is it is easier to enter a gray space, you know, because resources are always limited, opportunities are unlimited. So how do you grade them? So even as a retailer, I'm sure Sadhavani is thinking of opening outlets. I mean, will you go into a pure white space or will you ask yourself the question, are consumers used to, you know, shopping in open format stores, you know, et cetera, et cetera? So there is a gradation. So all that I'm saying is, when I use the word gray space, it's just a catch-all phrase for things which are not zero. There's a difference between a binary of zero. We think in terms of binaries of zero and 100. It's either there or not there. Often the easiest thing to do is where it's somewhat there.
Okay. One more I don't know question, then we'll go back to the panel and come back to you. There's a hand which has gone up. Okay, right.
Hello. Good evening. This is Varun Modi from Amul. One question that bothers me a lot is that most of the online players, that is e-commerce, are into model of discounting. You know, there is one modern format store that is into competition of other modern format store. They will discount, and that process continues. So my question is that to Saurabh sir is that how will you ensure that there is customer loyalty? Because what we have observed is that the customer switches as soon as he gets a better deal somewhere else. So in terms of online, that is part A of the question. And the second question is that as a brand, how do you ensure that the platform, the e-commerce platform that you're using, the customer loyalty remains?
He doesn't know how customer going to be loyal to you, Saurabh.
why do you think e-commerce or any retailer discounts, right? Customers are loyal to the value that they are getting, whether it's because of discounting, whether it's because of the quality of product that they're buying. If customers see value in something, they will be loyal to it. If they see value in, okay, I get my product cheaper at this store, so I'll buy from that store, they'll continue to buy from that store. If they see value in that, okay, this brand creates products which are superior in quality, even if it's expensive, but if that's what they want, they'll continue buying from there, that brand, right? I think the key here is that we need to understand where the customer and product gap is. If customers are looking at a product and saying that, okay, I'm not buying this product at this price until someone gives me this product at a cheaper price, then the signal that you're getting from customers is that customers do not see the value for what you are charging them. And that is a problem that fundamentally needs to be solved, whether we call it a discounter model or we say that, okay, the way the products are getting from a brand's manufacturing facility to customer, it's too expensive. Customers aren't willing to pay for it. So we need to figure out how do we actually figure out a way to price these products cheaper. And that's what most of the retailers and brands are trying to figure out. Like, how do I sell my products cheaper to customer where customers actually see value in it?
Okay. So I'm going to come back to the panel and come back to you. Thanks for the three questions. I'm going to start with where the gentleman left, sort of. And I don't know one thing about... There's a website, I think it begins with the word G. And there are two brands which I saw yesterday. chai ka brands. One brand was retailing at 398 on that same website. And there was another brand, I think, called Happy Day, which was retailing at some 154. Yeah. So my point to you is not about why 154. Yeah. I think that possibly you tried to answer him. Yeah. I'm saying, why will that other brand, which happened to be Red Label, what is the motivation for that brand to stay on the website? I mean, I don't know how they're going to both coexist with such a kind of price difference.
I think they will coexist for sure. I think we are trying to look customers from just one lens. I think every customer wants very different things. And one of the things that is happening in this technology era is that customers are demanding a lot more customizations for themselves. Customers are saying that this is what I want. So we have customers on our platform who will come and say that, okay, I want to buy tea, but it should not cost me more than $150. And then we as retailers or brands, we need to figure out how do I create a product that we are able to sell at 150 rupees. But there are customers who are saying that, okay, I have this brand affiliation and I want a much more superior quality product. And even if it costs 400 rupees, I don't care. I want that product. So I think customers are picking and choosing what they want. And most of us retailers and brands are trying to figure out how to fulfill that need.
Sudhir, I would have asked your view on this, but I'm going to skip that now. You can reserve it for a lunch fight with Saurabh later. I'm going to ask you, Sudhir, he agrees with him. Fine. Amitabh was complaining today that, you know, people don't fight on the panel anymore. So we have to do something to make people fight. Sudhir, your question to you. I think you were in the news recently. I think when a brand of nourishment was up for sale and people are taking the bet saying, is it a large beverage company or is it a large Ayurvedic company which is going to take it? Suddenly we heard that Unilever has bought this brand. Yeah, but I'm going to pick up from the thread which went on. I don't know whether in the future, where people are going to make micro choices on pricing, the motorcycle generation, all these words we are hearing, direct communication, I don't know what's going to be the relevance of brands. I mean, are brands going to be relevant in the era of future, or is it just about price and experience?
I mean, given the fact that we paid 40,000 crores for a brand called Horlicks, I hope it stays relevant. Otherwise, we'll be in trouble. But look, you know, I mean, obviously, I'm a marketeer, you know, from Lever, so obviously we have a point of view on this. But another thing to think about is that brands have been around, you know, for the last 150 years in consumer goods, round about the time of the Industrial Revolution in England, when choices became plentiful and you needed a shorthand to make decisions. You know, in a non-industrial revolution era, you could go to the nearby butcher or grocer and choose what you wanted. Now, therefore, as choice has become more and more complex, we find that brands become more and more valuable. So if you take the top 10 brands, take the top 10 most valuable companies in the world, they're all consumer brands now. It was not the case even 20 years ago. I'm saying Google's a consumer brand, may not be an FMCG brand, but it's a brand, all right. Facebook's a brand, and you know, so I actually feel that as life becomes more complex, as choice becomes more difficult, brands have a bigger role to play and not a smaller role to play, and a lot of the value that is there in the market will ultimately be attributable to brands, and that's what the delta value is going to be in terms of assets, and not many other class of assets that we see. But that's the party line.
I completely agree with that, and I think shoppers and consumers are very sophisticated about this. So they can make choices between products where the values that are inherent in the product they're buying are really important to them, and there they'll be guided by the brand names they trust or admire, or where they think the brand adds to their own reputation, and that's particularly true in, for example, Scotch whisky. But there are also brands or sectors where they really don't care about the brand. And so in the UK, sorry to use that example, but you have this extraordinary phenomenon where now really quite ordinary people are buying their weekly groceries from four different sources. So they'll buy their staples from Lidl or Aldi, the discount retailers. They'll then go next door to Marks and Spencers or Waitrose and buy much more upscale products. Then they'll also buy from online retailers for where availability is a different issue, or where they can only find a particular product through an online. And then they'll add a top off all of that with healthy products, and possibly with their lunch and daily lunchtime or breakfast. I mean, something like 46% of people in the UK eat breakfast while walking. So they're walking to work. Now, they're not going to do that through a traditional retailer. So I think brands will give them the point reference points on the map, but I don't think that that necessarily means that the same sort of brands will always be retained. The brands will have to adapt and evolve, and I think that's the key thing. If you want to survive in the modern food and drink market, you've got to be aware that this very different topography of brands is going to operate going forward.
So I want to ask you the next question, Ian. And I think you've spoken very passionately about how the need for reformulation to control obesity. And maybe it's very relevant for us because it's one of the countries with highest incident of diabetes as well. But here's my question to you. I think this is a country which is just about getting richer. And as you keep getting richer, the need to have a small indulgence, have a small sweet, add a lot of sugar in chai is quite prevalent. Are you trying to disrupt this by suddenly trying to tell us that, guys, reformulate your stuff, control your sugar? Is it ironical?
Certainly ironic. I think the shopper and the consumer has a pretty dusty view of this. I think most consumers and shoppers are pretty clear on what they need to do. Now, it may be that they get the wrong information, and I think that is the democratizing power of our age, that we have much more access to information. Actually, we have so much access to information that it's quite difficult to know which is right and which is wrong. And that's where, in the modern age, better education will be important. But I think telling consumers what to do is extremely dangerous. And I one thing that I think is really interesting, and this may not be a question for now, is if it is true that marketing in going forward will be about a personal relationship between the retailer, the manufacturer, and the consumer and the shopper, why would regulation not be? And how will regulation keep up with that? Because we currently have, in almost every country I can think of, regulation is aimed at whole population measures. But in an age when the marketing is one-to-one, and you have a personal relationship with the brand, how is it possible to sustain that kind of really blunt attitude to regulation? I don't know the answer to that.
I think it's quite a controversial point you raise, but I think we'll park it, and it's a good thing to discuss it and think as policy leaders later. Arvind, to you, I think, I don't know is the theme, and I hear you that I see you opening a lot of stores. You did tell about your success in Argentina, 5,000 stores, fantastic, and maybe much, much, much more multiples in India. I don't know whether that's the way forward for a brand like yours. I mean, your brand, you on one hand, you say it's personal, I'm going to reach out to everyone, but then you are also going the traditional way of opening as many outlets as you can. And that has its own dynamics about a distributor, his return on income, supply chain cost, returns, etc., etc. So I don't know whether that's the real way forward for a brand like Sri Sri Tattva.
Yeah. So nicely put, Sadashiv. So as you know, India is a very complex and a very dynamic market. Any brand that really has to survive here in the country has to have a very strong TT support. So you talk about e-commerce, you talk MTO, but really what's the backbone of any brand or any company per se is on the traditional trade format. Any big brand, more than 85% to 89% of their actual income comes from the traditional trade sector. And this is something that what we cannot ignore. What we as a brand are doing is that we're actually making a necklace out of what these three questions actually did, saying that what's there on rural, what's there for a brand, and also what a company is going to do about it, is that what we are really doing is we are educating the rural background also and creating entrepreneurs. 10 years back, a company would be very happy creating salesmen. But what have we done? We are creating entrepreneurs, and we're very successful on that. And rural India is so dynamic when it comes to performance, or when people really want to do something new, it's so amazing. And this is some talent that what we've really not been able to tap in because the technology wasn't there to do that. But today, any rural person that you would see would have a smartphone, not even a cell phone, a smartphone, and he would know more features than what you would possibly think that he could know of. Another point is that with regards to the e-commerce section, is that that's where we are really tying down both. We are tying down both our traditional trade and also our e-commerce to see that how both can marry and, you know, really work together. Having said that, an e-commerce marketplace is different from that of a brand being there on a marketplace. So, you know, a couple of brands can have, you know, different pricing, and that's what the marketplace has. But as a brand, for us to sustain in the e-commerce space or in any space per se, we need to ensure that the brand promise should be there at any point in time. If I say that this is what's that's there on the label, this is what you would get. Customer loyalty and consumer loyalty is based on whether you're able to satiate whatever the customer wants at that point in time, whether your promise is delivered to them or not. But when it comes to us as a brand, we've always seen that we are innovative to see that how we could reach out to people personally. As a brand, we are very well known for the personal connect. We are known for quality. So this is where we are also tying down technology to see that how we could deliver our products better to people. Some places we are strong, and in some places our delivery might not be as great, so which is why we have strategic tie-ups with different e-commerce players who are able to deliver better to those pin codes in a much faster manner. So as you know, we also have a strategic tie-up with Big Basket. So they're strong in certain areas, whether it's rural, tier 1, tier 2, tier 3 cities, and so are we. So we see that going forward, due to technology, I'm sure that all brands can come together and really see that how can we service the customer better. So it's no more just about you and me fighting across on a panel saying that who can deliver better, but there's so much space for everybody that what technology has created, that we are able to deliver better to the customer rather than to think that, you know, how can we do better than one another. I think that's the change that's come out.
Sure. So egged by the three questions which you asked, we had four I don't know questions. I think the gentleman here seemed to be knowing clearly what those answers are. I think Saurabh started by saying there's a customer for both the segments. Okay, there's a low priced private brand and there's a national brand, there's a customer for both. Sudhir chipped in and said brands are going to be strong and they'll continue to be strong even in the era tomorrow, and it had an echo from Ian. Ian also mentioned that it is indeed ironical, and that regulation and communication should not preach down to the customer. And we had Arvind, who kind of topped it up, saying traditional trade is here to stay. We may need to collaborate, we may need to find convergence, but traditional trade is here to stay. I think fantastic points by all of them. If we have time for a couple of questions, maybe we can have, but two questions? Okay, we have time for two questions.
Hi, my name is Kamal Prakash. I'm the country head for RSPO, it's a sustainability standard. My question is, if you think the consumers in India, especially the new rising millennial consumers, is there a demand for more eco-friendly products which are produced responsibly? And all of you are obviously involved in businesses which are buying several commodities, raw materials, and definitely the agro commodities as well. So do you see that as a trend, that in India we're going to see consumers who are more educated, urban consumers, asking for eco-friendly products which are not damaging the environment, the soil, or even the social factors like labor or, you know, the farmers' welfare? How do you look at this? And if you speak to your procurement teams about these topics?
So you want to go on?
I think this market's already there in the country. There are a lot of responsible brands, you know, a lot of us are sitting here also on stage who actually believe in this and giving back to society as well. So if you're saying that, is there a rise for eco-friendly products? What I would say, there's already a very strong base and there's a lot of opportunity in it. And the space is just unlimited. So it's not only from FMCG, you could look at other areas as well, and eco-friendly products. Consumers are very, very educated. They actually know what's coming on your pack. What does your brand stand for? All right, are you promising? Are you delivering? All these things are very, very clear. So with technology, I'm sure that you could educate people, and there is a lot of scope for such products in India and globally as well. So for example, in in Europe per se are there was a real thing that was going on WhatsApp saying that why do you have a cover for a toothpaste. So this was something that what we took into cognizance, and now our toothpaste that's going to go across there to Europe and to Iceland over there, we send it without any cartons. So social media could give you good pointers. You need to validate it whether these ideas are good, as what Sadashiv also mentioned, that you need to see the authenticity behind what's there, and also whether it's correct. Because some people, because of social media and the reach, they're able to say whatever they want on social media, but you need to see whether it's authentic or not.
Thank you. Thank you.
There's a hand which has gone up there. There's a hand which has gone up there, yeah.
Hi. My question is to all of the panel. We were talking about different price points and different types of customer, be it urban, poor or affluent. My point is, if you are marketing a private brand or a low-cost brand, how do you ensure the brand's quality in the customer's mind?
I think he's saying if there's a customer for every price, and if you're going to keep dropping the price, how do you ensure quality?
No, my question was, how do you assure the customer about it?
How do you assure customer the quality?
The question that Sada asked on the nature of brand. The brand is a quality promise at the end of the day, and that is why brands sell, and it answers the question on what was selling at 350 and what was selling at 150 rupees. So if brands vary quality, that is the primary trait of a brand is the quality that it represents. So if it varies the quality, you know, it takes a big, big knocking in the marketplace, and that's the learning we've had across the board across years. So that's the answer to that.
Actually, my question was something else. If I'm looking at a new brand, say for example, a tea at 154 rupees instead of 398 rupees per kg, how am I being assured about its quality, whether it's good?
No, I'm saying this is the classical marketing question, which is that the brand at 350 rupees has advertised and built quality parameters for itself. Consumers try it. If it doesn't fit the quality that the brand has promised, you have high lapse rates. And there's no way on earth in a country like India where consumers are so value conscious on products that you can have something at 350 and something else at 150 without having a product quality difference. So
I also feel, I think there was some point in what he made of brand authenticity. I think Ian made that point. I think both of the gentlemen said there's a market for it and a brand for it. As long as you don't overpromise what your promise is, I think you're good. So the 158 rupee brand should not make promises which possibly it cannot deliver. Saurabh, unless you have anything.
Yeah, I think, customers understand the difference in value, right? When customers are buying product which is worth 400 rupees versus when they're buying 150 rupees, they have different expectations from that. And you can only price products to a point where customers are buying it. If I keep reducing the prices and customers see, oh, this quality isn't good, so you can't reduce prices further, right? So customers understand the value and they see that, okay, this is the difference that I'm getting. If they are happy with that difference, that becomes the quality benchmark for that product. Quality is not universal, right? Quality is basis that product and what it is costing that customer.
Thanks a lot. I think I hope all of you have taken some of the provocations back home, which we can conclude maybe at a later date. But for now, I think a big round of applause to all the four panelists here. Yep. That wasn't big enough, but it's okay.